All right, let's start. Hi, I'm Elizabeth. That's me. I work for GitHub. I used to be a PHP developer. I am no longer that. I now work on the community team of GitHub. So what I do is mostly sponsorships. So I work sponsoring conferences like this in North, South, Central America. And then I have a counterpart who is over in Dublin, and she does the rest of the world. So together we are the sponsorships team. And it was really interesting coming to work for GitHub. I, of course, always was a huge fan of GitHub, but one of the things that we do and that I find really fascinating is we use a lot of old tools to solve some new tricks and to solve old problems. So this is a saw, right? Does anybody know, can you read, or have you seen a saw like this before? Do you know who actually makes this saw? Anybody? Can you read it? Probably not. This saw is made by a company called Stradivarius, which also, I don't know if you've heard, they make violins. And this is actually a musical saw, right? So, which is really cool if you go to YouTube and you just search musical saw. It's super badass. Like, it will blow your mind. It's crazy what they're how they're playing the saw. It's beautiful and crazy. And it just kind of sums up the way I like to solve problems. Because you have access to a lot of things and a lot of tools, and you can look at them in new ways and really come up with some interesting solutions. So that's my saw story. Old, new, old, remember that. So here's just a little disclaimer that GitHub, obviously, we love our repos, right? Like, that's what we're all about. So we have this kind of unhealthy obsession with them. So your mileage may vary, and of course we have access to unlimited repos. So you may not, but if you do, if you have access to a lot of them, I hope that this talk will be helpful for you and other people on your teams or in your companies. You can take this back to them. So when I started, which is a little over a year ago, a year and a couple months, there was one person on the community team. Her name is Cami, and she's fantastic, and you should all email her, cami@github.com, and say you're awesome. Thank you for being wonderful. Because this woman was doing all of the sponsorships for the whole world. She was doing all of the education requests. We give free GitHub accounts to students and teachers to use in their classrooms. So she was setting all of those up manually. We also give GitHub accounts to nonprofits. So she was handling all of those. If you're a nonprofit organization, you can get a free GitHub account, organization account. So she was doing all of those. She was doing all of our charity events. We have Dodgeball and the Octo Gala and other fun things that we do for charity. She was doing all of those, blood drives, everything. All the office tours. That was Cami. Like, this one person did, like, 10 people's worth of jobs. So when I started, there was Cami, and then a few months later, my counterpart came on. So in the course of splitting up her duties, we did have some growing pains. So I just want to talk about those a little bit. So the first pain we had was that all of the discussions were happening in inboxes. Everything was in Cami's email box. That was the only place where it existed. And that's pretty problematic for a few reasons. The first one is, when something's just an email box, no one else can see what's going on unless you're brought specifically into the email thread, right? So it's really not great as far as visibility goes. And GitHub, we're all about transparency and collaboration. Like, everything is open to everybody. But basically, you can collaborate on any part of the company at any time. Anybody can, right? So it's kind of a weird place to be. Like, some people find that kind of uncomfortable. Like, you don't want people, you know, in your stuff. But it's actually quite fascinating, because what happens is you realize you can't keep up with everything. So you kind of you gravitate towards the things that you're really interested in and you care a lot about. So it kind of is a self-filtering method. But nobody could see what was going on unless we specifically brought them into the conversation. Nobody could comment or collaborate on any of the sponsorship decisions or any kind of anything, which is not great. It's also really easy for an email to get buried underneath the stack, right? I'm still trying to solve this problem because I get a lot of emails. And then you have no historical context, right? If you weren't involved in that original email, and when I came on board, the only way I had to know is what we did for people last year, what happened in the past, was for Cami to search through her email inbox and forward to me all of the emails that she could find that might be pertinent to this conversation. So not super great, right? Pain number two, our information was difficult to collect. So when we were trying to decide if we're going to sponsor an event, And just to give you a slight bit of context here, we're now getting about 200, 250 requests for sponsorships every month. So there's a lot of stuff going on, which is really awesome. The industry, our industry is fantastic and amazing, because I don't really see other industries that happening. You know, like I was making the joke, I think, to Keith last night, like you don't really see dentists go, hey, we should totally do a dentistry conference, right? Like, does that happen? I don't, maybe it does, I don't know. But our industry is really unique in that. So it's like all community events, right? It's pretty awesome. So we're trying to get information, like how many people are going to be there? Where is it? What's the date? What's the URL? Like just simple information. But there's a lot of back and forth between us and the conference organizers to get enough information about the event. So it was really kind of tricky and time consuming and tedious. Our third pain was that we just kept everything in spreadsheets. We just started putting it all in a spreadsheet, right? Like as you do. And it's super shitty. Like who wants to work in spreadsheets all day? Certainly not me, because they really are made from the devil, right? They are the devil's plaything, are these spreadsheets. So I don't recommend using them for non-spreadsheety things. It's really not a super efficient way to track anything, keep up with what's going on. So that was a huge pain. We couldn't sort, we couldn't find things, we couldn't, it was terrible. Our next pain is that all our tasks are getting lost. So like when we agree to sponsor something, there's a list of stuff you gotta do, right? And if someone were to come to me and say, hey, did Sunshine PHP, did they get their, send in their invoice? Did we pay them yet? I had no idea. I had no way to know if it had happened, how I would just have to search in my email box to see if I could find an invoice from them somewhere. So the tasks were totally getting lost. And it was literally like a Where's Waldo game every time somebody asked me a question, because I had no idea. Oh, and I do have a comment about this. So we have a repo for presentations. So I put this talk up there, and one of our designers jumped in and was like, yeah, no, I got to fix this, right? So he made my slides all pretty for me, which was really awesome. But he also, I know he switched out my Where's Waldo picture, because now I can no longer find him. He is not in there. I'm so pissed off at Joel. Like, Joel's, he's in trouble. And I've looked, and I've actually spent quite a lot of time looking for this. Do you see him? Keith? He might be. Maybe he like photoshopped him out. I would not put it past him. That is an excellent point. So anyway, so if you download these slides and you actually find him, just please tell me where he is, because I don't know. It's driving me crazy. Ah, yeah. So our next pain is we didn't have any metrics around anything. Like the only thing we could tell you is maybe how much money we spent total of the year. We didn't have a clue where we were sponsoring events, what countries or locations, an easy way to tell. We had no way to know what languages we were giving more love to and leaving others behind. We had no way to forecast, like we have a gut feeling as to how the conference ebbs and flows. You know, spring's big time, summer's kind of dead, fall's really big. So if we were gonna, you know, get some help from other people, we had no idea when or what we were doing. And we really had no sum of all the requests we were getting. So we just knew the ones we said yes to. We didn't keep track of the ones we said no to. We said, sorry, we can't, we don't have any money left. But we didn't really keep track of that. So that was problematic. We had lots and lots of manual labor, lots of emailing, lots of back and forth. And we've learned to clone sheep, but we haven't learned to clone humans yet. So until that day, obviously anything that requires a lot of manual labor is definitely not scalable, right? So the only way to solve those problems was just to add more people on, and that seems not like a best solution to things. So that was not great. So we sat down in about June, July of last year, and we said, all right, here's our problems. What are we gonna do about all this? This is not gonna work, and the amount of requests we're getting are increasing, so it's just gonna get worse. So how are we gonna find solutions? Sure enough, to the rescue, GitHub, yay, repos, just in the API. They've completely solved our problems. So, and I'm gonna tell you how. So we've started out with a sponsorship repo. So now everything just goes in a sponsorship repo, which is amazing. We have this handy little form on our website, community.github.com, where you can go and you can request a sponsorship, or you can request event space at our headquarters, because we have a huge first floor that we host a lot of community events, user groups, and things like that. So you can go there and you can check it out and see what that looks like if you have an event that's coming up. And it uses the GitHub API to take all that information, and then it does stuff with it, which I'll talk about in a second. Is anybody using the GitHub API right now for anything exciting? Sort of? Are you using it for, like?
Very boring.
Just very boring things? Anybody else using it? Do you use it a lot, Brian?
Yeah, I didn't write it, but Bobby from Tiffany uses it to merge all the
forward
class. Nice. Command line utility that, like, merges stuff and comments.
Awesome. Yeah. Awesome. Is that the KMP Labs thing?
No, he made it. It's like it's called GH.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, cool. So a couple people are using it. It's actually pretty cool, and we have pretty extensive documentation on the site. It's developer.github.com, and there's pretty much everything you would need to know about the GitHub API is on this site, so I'm not going to go through it all. Yes, sir?
You throttle by account or by IP address?
I know. I told you I was going to look that up because I didn't know. I think it's by IP address. So thanks, Brandon, for your question. So pretty much everything you would want to know. We have a whole team that just works on the API. That's all they do. So it's extremely important to us that it's easy to use, well-documented. If you have questions or problems, you let us know for sure. Some things you can do with the GitHub API, just some examples. Pretty much anything you can do at GitHub, you can do through the API too. So like notifications, what you're starring, watching, changing your stars and watches and things. Gists, you can create a gist, you can edit, you can share, delete. Issues, same thing, create, edit, close, all of those, anything you can do with an issue, put a label on it, whatever. You can actually render a markdown file through the GitHub API. You can do searches on pretty much any part of the site. Pull requests, you can open pull requests, you can close them, you can comment, you can search, delete. Repositories, you can create a repository through the API, you can get lists, get information, edit, whatever you need to do. Users, you can get user information. You can change your profile information through the API. You can see how many followers. You can see who's following you, who's following people that you're following, things like that. And of course, you can always get the list of emojis because emojis are huge at GitHub. We love our emojis so much. There is a PHP GitHub API client, which Brandon was kind enough to point me to, and that's the KMP Labs that I just mentioned. So you can check this out. I haven't really looked at it a lot, but it's definitely worth taking a peek at. So if you're interested in that. So now, when we get that information from the community page, it opens an issue for us right there. And this is what it looks like. So this was the request we got from Sunshine PHP. This was all automatically populated. I had to do nothing for it. It was right there. It's pretty awesome. The task list goes on, but I had to cut it off. But this is all marked down, so it was all automatically put in there. And then we just check it off as we're doing it. So it's pretty awesome. So now instead of everything being in an email inbox, it's in an issue, and anybody can see. Anybody can watch the repo. They can see what kind of requests we're getting, which is really awesome. They can kind of get a better feel for what it is that we actually do, because it gets kind of lost, you know, if we're not writing code. Like, what are you doing all day? Anybody can see. Anybody can comment and collaborate, which is really great. Because I am a PHP person, I've been in the community a really long time, so I know the PHP community really well. I don't know, like I kind of know the Ruby community a little, and I kind of know the Python community a little, but I don't really have firsthand experience with some of those events. So if there's someone else at GitHub that can just pop in and be like, yes, we totally have to sponsor this, it's a great event, don't miss this one, you know, or make sure that these guys are supported or whatever. Like that's super helpful context for me. Because otherwise, I'm just working in a silo, like I'm just going on whatever information I'm given by the organizers, right? So it's extremely helpful to have context from other people. It's much less likely now for something to get buried, because I have a list, all my open issues, there they are. Ta-da, amazing. It's not just emails. I mean, I still get buried in emails, don't get me wrong, and I'm sure I probably owe half this room email replies, so sorry. But it's a lot more transparent, it's a lot more visible, and a lot less likely to get buried. And another great thing is if we add in the person to our team, they have access to all the information that we have access to, right? They can easily search through the repo and see what we did for somebody last year, see what the whole conversation was, why we decided to not sponsor something or to sponsor something. Like, they have it all right there. You don't have to send anybody. You don't have to include anybody. It's all right there. Super, super helpful. Instead of the back and forth, trying to get the information from the conference organizers, it's all right there, right? Like, they did it for me. I didn't have to do anything. And I know how many people are going to be there. I know the URL. I know where it is, when it is, what, you know, what the sponsorship options are. All of that is right there. Super, super easy. Spreadsheets, unfortunately, we still do have to use them. So they get a little one horn because we still have to use them. But actually, we're using them for spreadsheety things, right? Like, we just keep track of the money now. So it's an extra step. It kind of sucks. But I don't really see a way around that yet. So we'll give them one little devil horn. It's fine. At least I'm not in there all the time putting everything in there. And instead of my Where's Waldo, right? Now I have all my Waldos are nice and neat and lined up. I can find them easily. I know exactly where they are. And I actually, they would be Octocat Waldos, Waldo Cats. In my case, so that's really nice. But it's super clear, easy, visible. Anybody can see. If I'm gone, if I'm in Hawaii on the beach at a bar or something, and somebody needs to know what's going on with something, it's all right there. They can find it very easily. And they can actually do my job for me while I'm gone, which is really good. And before, we didn't have any metrics. And now we have all the metrics we need, because you can use the labels that you use on the repos to run reports. And it's super, super easy to do. So we can see. I don't know if you guys remember. Let me just go back here and show you. See, we label them with the year, month. Right now, we're just doing the continent and then the general topic. We may change this later, but this is what we're kind of doing for now. So we may make it a little more granular later. The problem is, like, then your label list is like 500 labels long, right? So that's a problem we haven't quite solved yet, but we're working on it. So we can run reports based on those labels, and we can see location, we can see what languages we're paying more attention to or leaving out. We can see, you know, what the trends are, what months are heavier than others. And we have an overall picture, because every request goes in the repo whether or not we sponsor. So it just gets a little sad, rejected tag because we didn't have money or for whatever reason. So that's extremely, extremely helpful. And here's just a really quick little chart that actually our marketing guy wrote some code to pull that out. So you can kind of see, like, these were based on just the topic that we had. So, you know, like, PHP, yeah, we're doing all right. Perl, we only had, like, one event. Sorry, Perl guys out there. But yeah, so it's just a quick, and this is not a great graph. Like, our designers are like, oh, no. We will make this much better. So they're working on that stuff for us, more of like a dashboard kind of thing, which is super, super helpful for us. And before, when we had to clone ourselves to get stuff done, we no longer have to do that. We have a little tool called Hubot. Has anybody played around with the Hubot? Yay, Pablo has. All right, nice. So, I mean, it's no Fergie, right, Matt? Sorry. But this is a little chat robot. He pretty much does a lot for us. So at GitHub, we use chat quite extensively, and we run a lot of commands through chat. So if you want to deploy to production at GitHub, you do that through the chat channel. And anybody can do that. Like, I could go in our chat channel and deploy to production, which is not going to happen. Like, don't worry. I'm not bringing down GitHub. Don't worry. But technically, I could do that if I really wanted to. And so it's pretty cool, you know, and he can, every time somebody opens an issue, it pops up a thing in the chat channel, you know, just little things like that. And it's completely open. You guys could fork it and use it at your own places of business or personal. It's pretty awesome. He does a lot of cool things. Actually, our chat ops, we call them chat ops, that's a whole other talk in and of itself. So it's pretty, there's a lot to it. So from the sponsorship to repo, like, sometimes when we sponsor a conference, they give us tickets, right? Hey, you sponsored at silver level, you can have 2 free tickets. Well, before, we had no way to really communicate that with the rest of the company. And we're extremely mobile, and a lot of us are remote. It's like 70-30. 30 are in San Francisco, where headquarters are. The rest of us are remote, and we're always traveling. Like, we even have people who don't have homes. They literally have no homes. They're just nomadic. So they just go from Airbnb to Airbnb, and they don't have a home. So, you know, to how am I supposed to know who's going to be in the area? Who would be in Miami that would want to take this ticket at a PHP? Like, I had no way to really do that. So we have an available tickets repo. Anybody can watch it. You can, you know, we can pull in people if we know. We can mention them, pull them in. But anybody can watch it and see what tickets come up that they can take advantage of. And likewise with speaking opportunities. People will contact GitHub and just say, hey, we don't even care what you talk about. Just, we want someone from GitHub to come talk to us, which is really strange. I think, like, that's weird. But all right, cool, you know. So And we really, really encourage our employees to speak as much as often as they want. That's something that we feel really strongly about. Even people who don't write code, you know, like our finance department, like you should get out and do talks. You know, our support cats, you should get out and do talks. Like, it's just something we feel really strongly about. So we have this repo that anybody can watch, take advantage of those opportunities when they come up. We have an Octo booth that we take to various conferences around. And so there's a lot of coordination issues with that. And you don't want to really muddle up anything else besides like the people who are going to be at the conference and need to know like where it is and, you know, how do I put the booth together or whatever. Like they can just specifically watch that repo or that issue. It doesn't have to, you don't have to involve the whole company on every aspect of that. And same thing if we have like an ad or something we have to print. There's a whole discussion that goes around that, what kind of format it has to be in, what's the size, what's the deal. So that's its own repo, but it's all related. It's all linked together, and you can see them all linked and whether or not they're open, and it's all really, really nice and handy. It was funny. We sponsored a conference called Ruby on Sails, and they had little sailboats. This is so badass. So we got to do a little sailboat flag. So we had a little pirate octocat with his little patch and a little thing. And it was really interesting, and all of that was open, and like you could see the whole design process and iterations, and everybody could comment, and you know, it's really cool. It's a really neat thing to know that anybody can collaborate on this stuff, and you can see what's going on. You feel like, you know, it's a cool, you can be a part of it. It's really awesome. We also sometimes will get support tickets straight in for conference things. We can link those. We can link swag requests. Somebody wants, you know, we need to send stickers, whatever. We can link that to it. If we're going to do a drink up, we'll link those plans to the same repo just to make sure that everybody who's going to that conference kind of knows what the deal is if they haven't been involved in planning the drink up, that kind of stuff. And at GitHub, if you are speaking at a conference, you get to bring a buddy with you. GitHub will pay to send someone with you so you're not going by yourself, which is really kind of awesome. So you can coordinate travel with your buddy through the repo as well. You can link it all together. So what else? It's not just us that uses GitHub all the time. We use it in every aspect, pretty much, of GitHub. Onboarding, when you start, you get an issue. It's all set up for you. Here's a checklist of all the stuff you need to do the first week, the stuff you need to read, how you set up your environment, videos you need to watch. Like, everything is right there. Anybody can help you out and collaborate if you're stuck on something. You can just post it in your issue. And it's all open and transparent. Everybody can see. We do user experience studies. So actually, we, in sponsorships, just opened an issue. So you just open an issue. Our user experience person, Christy, who is wonderful, she takes a look at the issue of all the questions you want answered. And she works with you. She'll open a gist, and you can see what kind of questions you want to ask your users or what kind of research reports you can get. All of that happens open in an issue, all that communication. So everybody can see, again, and collaborate with you and be a part of that conversation. So it's open to anybody. If I was working on GitHub for Mac team and I wanted to maybe add a feature and I didn't know if it was going to be something that users would appreciate and use and like. So I would open an issue with Chrissy and say, hey, all right, let's check this out. Let's do some research and see what we want to do. Policy conversations. So just as an example, we also have like a community team repo. And we, like as I said before, we offer nonprofits free GitHub accounts. So the question came up, well, what if I'm a public library? It's not technically a nonprofit, but as we know, they are not swimming in cash, right? So so we had a big conversation about that, and we decided, sure, let's go ahead and extend it to them as well. So if you guys work for public libraries, you can get a free GitHub account. Yay. But those kinds of things, and like the conversation's there, and it's documented. And so if anybody in the future wants to know why are we giving libraries GitHub accounts, they're not nonprofits, well, hey, you can go read the whole conversation and know why we decided to do that. Our finance team uses it. They use it for a lot for project management. They just did an implementation to NetSuite. So they just kept track about all their issues in a repo just for the NetSuite stuff. And they had, you know, then they had track of each separate thing they had to do right there all together. We use it to collaborate on documentation. All of our documentation, external, internal, is all done through the repos. A document of code is the same as a document of words, right? And you can obviously fork, pull requests, all of that good stuff as well. So, and also, you know, so if you're working on GitHub for Mac and you, so at GitHub, you can kind of switch around teams. You're not stuck on one team forever. You can kind of float around a little bit. So if you're coming to the GitHub for Mac team, then you need to kind of know how things go in that project specifically. So we keep all of that stuff documented as well. And it's all done in repos. We also keep track of office-y kind of things in an office repo, right? So if you need toilet paper on the bathroom floor one, you open an issue. You don't have to email anybody or bug anybody or anything. You just open an issue, and then the magic office fairies come and take care of it, and they close the issue, and they fix it. So it's pretty cool. Like, you know, you can kind of see. Or if somebody's pissed because the sun comes in a window, you know, they can, it, I don't know. Seems silly, but it's actually quite efficient and nice. Sometimes we get together, our teams will get together and do what we call hack houses. So we'll just pick a location somewhere and just say, hey, everybody go to Mexico City, or hey, everybody go to Tahoe or whatever, and we're going to just spend a week hacking on this, and we're going to ship some stuff. So that's awesome, but it takes a lot of coordination to make that happen, and that way everybody's involved. They know exactly what's going on. They know what the deal is. You don't have to email everyone all the time, and anybody can see, anybody can pull in, anybody's welcome to come. I could go just hang out with them and watch them hack, I guess. I don't know what I would do, but I would be their moral support. Our legal team uses it. If we see any employee sees any kind of copyright stuff or weirdness, they can just file an issue. The legal team will take care of it, and you can discuss it. It's all right there. Actually, it's pretty cool. We had we just did our internal IP documents. They're really, they're really not very well written most times. They're total legalese. They're like 6 pages long. Nobody really understands who owns what when you're working on a project for the company on company time. You know, like, who owns that? So we opened an issue, and everybody just kind of collaborated on the document, and we came up with like a page and a half. It's completely simple. Everybody understands it. Everybody buys into it. Our lawyer obviously signed off on it that, yeah, this is a binding document, not just some crazy words. But it was just a really cool process, you know, because you kind of felt like you had ownership of that, and it wasn't just some 6-page document that you had to read and agree to. You had a little bit more buy-in. We have a repo. It's kind of like a Craigslist repo where people can just sell stuff. And most of the time it's like, oh, I got an iPad or a Mac. But I thought this was really funny. So I don't know if anybody lives in San Francisco that's here. Is anybody from San Francisco? Oh, Noelle is. I'm sorry, Noelle. I'm so sorry. But so just to give you an idea, like, everybody bitches about the cost of living in San Francisco. But this was, and someone made this point, this was actually a good enough deal that it made it to our repo. Like, hey, guys, get on this. So if you can't read it, it says an apartment, a one-bedroom, 574-square-foot apartment, is $3,380 a month. And that's a good, that's a good deal in San Francisco. Holy shit. Like, I'm from Cincinnati. We don't pay that. Like, you would not pay that for that. Crazy, right? So I thought that was funny. I didn't reply to that issue, but I really wanted to. I didn't want to get like flames and torches, but I was like, God, you guys are nuts. Anyway, so that's fun. We also do toasts. Like, when somebody does something awesome, we take pictures of ourselves and we put it all in an issue and we toast them with, you know, drinks or food or whatever hijinks we want to toast with. And then we have a little script that runs and it puts it all in an animated GIF. It's pretty awesome. Super fun. So that's awesome that we use GitHub because we love GitHub and we try to use it as much as we can. But what about the rest of the world? Are they using it for other things besides code? I'm so glad you guys asked that question because I will answer it. So governments have started to use GitHub, which is a really kind of awesome thing. We have a guy, and that's all he does, is kind of advocate and evangelize the use of GitHub in governments. His name is Ben Balter. He's a really great guy. He used to be with the DCPHP group. I'm sorry?
No question. There's Germans that actually put all their laws in GitHub as well.
Nice, yeah.
They can all the changes to the laws. It's not really real.
Did you guys hear what Derek said? That there's a group in Germany, right, you said? That has all the laws out there, so you can diff and see what laws have changed and where they've changed. And that's pretty much what the San Francisco Mayor's Office for Civic Innovation is doing with the open law, so you can actually see. Now, you can't fork it and then make your own changes and then submit it back. Like, they're not super down with that. Yeah, you could. I guess you could try. Like, I don't know, but it might be a waste of your time. you have a question? No, can't. I don't think you can. Well, yeah. The United States actually has, the U.S. government has some repos out there. I thought this was interesting. They have a one that's called just glossary. So it's all of their definitions of what they think things mean versus like what our definitions of what things mean, right? That's kind of funny if you want to go look at that. The city of Philadelphia has all of their police complaint data. It's in a CSV, which is kind of sucky, but you can go and actually see and take that data and do some fun stuff with it. If you want to see where not to, to live or be caught doing something bad, I guess, that's where you would want to go. I thought it would be really awesome if somebody would make this app that just says, can I do it? And it would, like, you would type in what you want to do, like, can I spit on the sidewalk? And it would, like, find where you are and, like, check the law and see if you're going to get in trouble for that, right? Like, I think that would be an awesome idea. Can I do it? Can I spit on the sidewalk? No, don't spit on the sidewalk. That's against the law. Okay, all right, I won't. But that, wouldn't that be great? Someone needs to take that idea. $1 million. Chicago also has a list of all their bike racks for, through the city, so you can... On what?
On the OSD bike
rack. Oh, yeah. Yes, right. Yeah, I think that's a pretty collaborative effort, right? Yeah, are you from Chicago? You're from Chicago, aren't you? Oh, nice. Have you ever used this?
No, because I'm not a biker, but I have friends who are.
Oh, nice. Well, there you go. He can testify. Also, a lot of scientists are using it, which is really cool. They're putting their research out there and trying to be more open with their collaboration instead of everybody working in their silos, trying to beat out everybody else on the research. So there's a whole movement for that, the Center for Open Science, and they have their own, like, policies and procedures are all out there, research papers. It's really kind of cool. I love that. Here's some books. Authors are putting all their stuff online, which is or on GitHub, which is really awesome. You can, you know, if you see something wrong, you can fix it for them. How amazing is that? And these are really good books, actually, by the way, so you should check these slides later. It's funny, I was telling somebody when I last night, when I was I wrote some books for Wiley, and that process was like 8 months long to get it from, you know, time that you approved it to like time. So, of course, everything's wrong by the time it goes out. So then people would be bitching at you. It's like, well, when we wrote it 3 years ago, it was fine, but sorry. So I'm really glad to see that that process has changed. There's also some fun stuff out here. This is actually a GitHubber. His name is The Daniel. And he bought this old bike, this old motorcycle, and so he just has all of his issues of the things that he wants to fix on his bike. So you could actually go there and see and give him advice if you wanted, or fix it for him and then check it off. I don't know. But it's just kind of a cool thing. Like, you can use it for personal projects as well. And of course, he has it all in issues and stuff. If you wanted to knit the snoo from Reddit, you absolutely could using these knitting patterns that this woman has. If you wanted to make it even better, you absolutely could do that. So that's kind of interesting, right? Like, it's just words, it's just documents, same as code. I think this was in the Atlantic, maybe, magazine a few weeks or months ago. This guy started this repo for taco recipes, and there's like 350 taco recipes out there now. Like, no shitting. Oh my God, who knew? I did not know they were so versatile. Because I'm personally more of a burrito fan. I think burritos are way better than tacos, but that's just me. But yeah, so if you're into tacos, you should absolutely go see what recipes you can find, add your own. How cool is that? At this point, I have to apologize to Evan.pro, who is giving a talk in another room. This is so awesome, you guys. So Matthew Weirofini told me about this last night, and I just shoved it in my slides. So he and his girlfriend actually have, I don't think they're married. They might be, I don't know, have this repo for their relationship out there. It's so hilarious. Oh my God, it's so great. It'll be like one of the issues is Elisa falls asleep too soon or something. So you go through and it's like the subject can't watch a whole movie at one time or something. She falls asleep before the opening credits. And then she's like, that's not a bug, won't fix. You know, I mean, it's so great. It is so great. So you guys have to go see this. It's hilarious. I chuckled heartily, so. I saw Evan earlier, and I was like, Evan, I'm just going to apologize right now if I embarrass you. And he's like, okay. I'm like, you'll understand why later. Keith, did you have a question? Add a child object, yeah. Yeah, I was like, oh, yeah. It wasn't one of them, I know. There was another one, too. Somebody else added, like, not married or something like that. It was like, wow, okay. So that might be the drawback to having that as a public repo, because you're going to get all kinds of stuff. Just one more. This guy bought this house. Not this house. He did not buy this house. He bought an old shitty house and was fixing it up. And he, again, like kind of like how Daniel did with his motorcycle. He has all of his issues. All of his permits are out there on a repo. Like, everything's kind of together, and you can kind of see his progress as he goes. So that's really actually pretty cool. I'm not sure what time this talk is supposed to be over, but I'm almost done. I just want you to remember that the tools you have available to you are really awesome, and they do amazing things. You just need to get to know them and explore them a little bit and open your mind so that you can use your old tools to solve new tricks. Old tools to solve new tricks to old problems. Something like that, yeah. So that's it. This is me. If you need to ask me any questions at all, if you have anything at all, just holler at me. There's my joined in link. If you would be so kind as to leave feedback, that'd be fantastic. I'd really appreciate that. Even if it's shitty feedback, like that's totally fine. I have no problem with that. Does anybody have questions? Questions? Yes.
Part of me thinks this is really cool, and part of me is like, if the only tool you have to solve the problem is a GitHub repo, then suddenly everything becomes something that can be solved in a GitHub repo.
Right, yeah. Well,
in other words, this is not necessarily the optimal solution for some of these things.
Correct. And in the case of the spreadsheets, you know, like it wasn't, that's maybe the only thing that you don't want to try to use spreadsheet. Like that's the only tool that you can't really use for other reasons, right? Like spreadsheets because they're so shitty. But yeah, I mean, obviously we have tons of these at our disposal and they don't solve all of the problems. Like they're not going to be as advanced for a project management tool, right? Like obviously other project management tools have their pros and cons as well. But the nice thing about for us is it's integrated into everything else. So it's all right there in one place, and it's very visible and transparent and easily accessible to everybody in the company. So it's kind of a, you know, you got to weigh it a little bit, I guess. So for us, that seems to work. But even though there are better project management tools out there.
It's still better for document things. I mean, at Rackspace, we use it for our social media guidelines.
Nice, yeah. Right, yeah. Perfect example of that. And I know some of you guys are thinking, like, hey, that's great, but like our finance people, there's no way in hell they would touch GitHub. And we do actually have, if you can start this conversation with them, I don't know, that's up to you, but we do have training.github.com, and we have GitHub guides. They're real fun videos, they're really quick, just to kind of, you know, ease them on into like what is even forking, what does that even mean? Like that's weird, I don't know what that is. If they would be willing to be open to those conversations, we do have some tools that we can kind of help you evangelize that a little bit. But yeah, so yes.
We use Jira for most of this stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. I mean, I don't know. It's just some food for thought, you know, to kind of maybe see what else you can do. I don't know. Yeah.
Yeah,
because you can use the GitHub website. Like, you don't have to know command line stuff to use GitHub website or GitHub for Windows or GitHub for Mac. Like, it's, you know, we try to make it as easy as possible for people who aren't comfortable with command line to still use the services and get some stuff out of it. So, anybody else have any questions? All right, you guys are awesome. Thank you.